You're listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network, now the largest new media platform on the web, and your number one source for after-show entertainment.
Very good, Dean
Johnson. From the AfterBuzz Studios in Los Angeles, California, presented by Maria Menounos and Bing.com, and streaming live thanks to Akamai Technologies, this is AfterBuzz TV's Project Runway After Show. We'll break down tonight's episode and get you all the latest news and gossip. If you'd like to buzz in on tonight's show, you can buzz us at 424-256-1729. That's 424-256-1729. And now, another post-game wrap-up show for your favorite TV show. It's AfterBuzz TV's Project Runway After Show.
Oh, yeah.
There it goes.
I like that one.
This is the real theme music.
That's real. That's the real one.
The one we used last season was all right.
Questionable.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I like that.
Hi, guys. Bing is for doing, and here at AfterBuzz TV, we're doing another Project Runway All-Stars episode season two, episode three. I confused
That's
myself.
Okay. I didn't know either. I was like, I don't know what episode this is.
This is episode three, Up Your Aerosol, and I thought it was a really fun episode, so we should get right into it. The challenge starts off, and this week they're doing wearable art.
Yeah.
So the whole up your aerosol comes in when we see these graffiti artists and huge graffiti walls. Mm-hmm. And they were at the largest space where legal graffiti art was allowed.
Yeah, pretty much. Like, it was a big wall and building. And when they arrived, there were three, I think there were three graffiti artists. And I guess they were, I would think of them as graffiti artists, but they were referring to them as aerosol artists. Yeah. I don't know why, like why aerosol versus graffiti, I don't know. But anyways, there were about three of them, you know, I want to say tagging, but it's not tagging.
But you know, maybe why, I think they call them aerosol artists because they don't just do graffiti on the walls.
Right.
We saw like paintings they had done, and their medium is aerosol, I guess.
Yeah. And I guess when you think of graffiti, you think of a certain look, you know, because I think graffiti art can be very artistic.
I do too.
But I don't know. Maybe there's a negative connotation too with being called a graffiti artist. Whereas, yeah, it's like a painter. They use paint. So an aerosol artist uses aerosol spray cans. So yeah. It was an interesting, I thought it was a really creative idea for a challenge.
I did too, and I loved it, and I love what they came up with. Mm-hmm. They had to create a pattern, and they were given a crate that had the aerosol sprays and a choice of white fabric. It could be cotton or it could be chiffon, I want to say she said.
I don't remember that part. That's probably really bad of me. I just remember that they got 7 yards of white fabric.
Yes.
And then they had that big crate with all the different colors of aerosol cans, and that's what they had to use. And then in addition to that, they had the $50 that they could choose to use at Mood if they wanted to buy anything extra, any notions or whatever to add to their piece.
And 15 minutes to shop there. They had 2 hours to sketch and create their print. Mm-hmm. And the design, they wanted to look equally good at an art gallery and on the runway.
Right.
So basically wearable art. We go back to that.
Yeah.
And we see the designers talking to the artists, getting inspiration that way. And right away they get into it.
Yeah.
Pretty tough because...
Yeah. That's a hard
If you mess
challenge.
Up, that's your print.
That's
7 yards
I didn't
can't
really
be
think
that
about
much.
That. And you know, and we didn't see anybody mess up. Like, I think it would be really easy, especially if you haven't used aerosol cans before. And, you know, they had the artists show the technique to the designers, and they showed them all these different things that they could do. And, I mean, if you've never done that, that's really hard, you know, to think, okay, this is the look that I want to accomplish, and then to be able to manipulate how you hold the can or where you place your finger when it sprays it. And actually execute it to look that way. They had to have messed up and maybe we didn't see it.
Maybe.
You know, maybe they could have, if they messed up, maybe they had the option of getting another 7 yards of fabric, you know, because that's a lot to ask to do.
Yeah,
I think
I mean, and let's say they didn't get an option to get more fabric. Yeah. I was really impressed with the prints overall.
Yeah.
Every print I saw, even as they were working on it, I was like, wow, that's beautiful.
Yeah.
Wow, that looks really well done, you know. Yeah. And they really proved themselves this week, because I was kind of disappointed last week. And
right. I was too. I agree with you. There, of course, and we'll get into that later, were the artists that were not so good at this.
There's always
technique. But also maybe they didn't seem like they were upset with their design, so maybe I didn't think they were great at this particular technique or skill, but apparently they executed what they envisioned, so it's really more a question of their actual design.
Yeah. And Josh and actually mentioned that he said it's like insulting somebody's looks.
Right.
You know, and I don't think that's necessarily the best
right
example.
Yeah.
But it's basically their taste right now.
Yeah.
You know, that what they think is artistic or beautiful is really.
That's a hard challenge. I mean, if somebody handed me spray cans, oh gosh, I would hope I could do something really great. But I'm not a spray can aerosol artist. You know, and these guys aren't either. And so the fact that they were able to pull off what they did, I too was impressed in what we later see.
Emilio made a good point at the graffiti park. Mm-hmm. He said he's not going to try to copy graffiti art because that can look cheesy if you're not good at it.
I agree.
So he kind of did a play on it, and we'll see how that turns out. Suede, while he's at the park, says, I'm going to pull back. The designers question my taste. I'm going to take it easy.
Yeah. Did he, though? No.
No. And then another thing I noticed at the graffiti park, I have to just mention this, Althea's whale tail.
Yes.
Her underwear was completely out, and they tried to blur it, but
G-string
at points.
All the way.
Oh, wait, girl. But, you know, you got to give her credit. She's like, I'm not letting my wardrobe stop me.
Yeah, she's not even paying any attention.
Yeah.
Another person that wanted to let their wardrobe stop them was Laura Kathleen, who made the comment when she saw that she was being asked to do this, you know, graffiti challenge or whatever you want to call it. She's like, I didn't come in the right clothes for this. She said, my shit's expensive. Those were her words.
She said, my shit's expensive.
Yes. You didn't hear her? She's like, I'm not wearing the right clothes
for this. I heard
that
part.
She
I didn't hear
they bleeped it.
Oh, because okay.
We don't have to do that, I don't think. So we're good. But those were her words, if you missed it. And
that's really tacky.
I think so too. And as we get into the workroom, you hear, you know, the different contestants talking about how Laura Kathleen always, anytime she refers to just like her upbringing, she always is commenting on money. Like she must have been brought up with money. She said something that her high school is more expensive than her college, that her, you know, grandma used to take her shopping at these expensive stores, or this is what the other contestants are saying.
Yeah, this is as we get into the workroom.
Yeah.
We notice that there is more conflict. We see the drama. Mm-hmm. You know, the first couple of episodes we're like, wow, everybody's pretty nice. Ivy's nice. Wendy Pepper wasn't that bad. Blah blah blah.
Right.
But now we kind of see, you know, the tension building. And like you mentioned, Laura Kathleen is a big topic. Who was it? Kane was telling Ivy about
Ivy,
the thing you mentioned, how she's always bragging about her upbringing and
they
money.
They were basically sitting during their lunch break, just kind of gossiping about her and how
laughing.
They obviously don't like her, gossiping and laughing. Ivy herself is no nice, sweet person.
No.
Okay. And I think you're right. When we went into this first episode, I know, I think Virginia and I had both seen Ivy's season, and I think Ivy and Laura Kathleen were in the same season, and so we knew a little bit about their personalities. We knew Ivy was a bitch, and I knew Laura Kathleen just kind of got under my skin. She's a little bit annoying,
oh, snap,
that's right,
And I get that startles right. me. Our wonderful engineer, Steven, is...
You're welcome.
Is going out of his way.
Well, it's the truth. Oh, Snap is so right because she's the two of them. They're drama. Let's
yeah, you guys, your predictions so far have been spot on. And mentioning Virginia, she couldn't be here tonight. Yes. But
she'll
we'll have her back next week.
Yeah.
So
that was an interesting scene to see Ivy and Kane sitting there gossiping and laughing. And then sure enough, who walks in? Laura Kathleen goes in to get their lunch and they kind of, you know, get quiet. She sits down right next to them like she's there to socialize and they're kind of snickering. I didn't think they made it so obvious that they were talking about her. But what was it? I think Laura Kathleen.
Laura Kath snapped. Are you mean? Are you being mean?
Are you
Ivy?
Having a mean streak, Ivy? Ivy actually hadn't even said anything to her. Ivy wasn't doing anything.
I would get bothered by that too.
Yeah.
It's like, come on.
Yeah. Yeah.
She's just using what she knows is going to bother Ivy.
I know. She says those things. She's that kind of a person, it seems like, that makes these like little jabs and comments. And
yeah. And I think we're going to see more of that too.
Oh, 100%.
And Joanna Coles walks into the workroom looking really polished and nice. You mentioned as soon as she walked in, you're like, ooh, I love that.
I always like what she wears. I just think she seems like such a cool lady. And whatever
Very
she wears,
chic.
She wears it well. You know, she's so professional. And
yeah,
fantastic.
I love that she was wearing leather. And she's an older woman, but she still made it look classy and really refined.
It was like a blocked leather. Like, basically, the front panel, like, you know, from her waist up was leather. But the back, I don't think, was leather.
No, it was like a fitted long-sleeve cocktail dress.
Oh, was it long sleeves?
Yeah.
The sleeves weren't leather.
No.
But I think the bottom...
Was it?
...part of the skirt on the back, I think, was leather. I feel like it, like they had blocked it.
Oh, cute.
Yeah. Either way, it looked very classy on her. She always looks great. I love
her. Yeah, she does.
Yeah.
We didn't see a lot of Casanova or Uli this week, but we did see more of Emilio.
Yes.
She mentioned his outfit looked like blood. She was kind of weary about it because he had used that drip technique the artist showed them.
Yeah.
And it kind of did look like blood when she mentioned it.
It did. Ooh, sorry. Yeah, it totally did. But you know what I noticed and what I really liked and what I was really impressed by? When Joanna went around to all the different designers and they talked to her about, you know, what their print was and maybe, you know, what they wanted to do with it. I was impressed by the technique that they used. I think the first person she went to was Althea and she said, oh, I love your print. And it was kind of like, what was it?
It's like a purple and yellow giraffe print.
Giraffe. Okay, that's a good way to put it. But the technique that she used, she said she did like a pink, just like a solid pink, and then she did the purple and yellow at angles.
Yeah.
And I thought, wow, that really turned out great. I totally agreed. And then getting to Emilio when he talked about the blood, I liked how he said he did the drip technique, and then he flipped the garment over so that when she actually wears it, it's dripping upwards. So I'm like, that's, you know, they're really
creative.
A lot of them got really creative, and I was really impressed with that.
She warns Kane that there's a fine line between hideous and fabulous.
Yeah.
And she wasn't kidding.
Right.
Kane was working on his graffiti gown.
Mm-hmm.
Two things that shouldn't go together. Wearable art, you know.
Right.
It just didn't work.
Well, I mean, if you think about the prints that we saw from some of the other designers that we, like, I really loved Uli's print.
Gorgeous.
If you put that into a gown... Because it didn't look like graffiti.
Work.
It didn't look like a spray paint.
No.
It looked like some kind of beautiful mural, you know?
I also liked Andre's print a lot.
Really?
The peacock.
Oh, yes. Yeah, it was pretty simple.
It was. I mean, I didn't love the dress, but the print was gorgeous. That could have been a gown.
Exactly. So I think and you know, when I saw his sketch, when I saw Kane's sketch, I thought, that's really gorgeous. It was, you know, the V-neck, I mean, the deep V that basically came down to, you know.
Halter.
To pretty much her belly button. And then, you know, fitted mermaid style. And which I thought was kind of creative, he was inspired by, you know, the outline that he saw in some of the work that they were, you know, looking at. So he got the black velvet, and that's kind of, you saw that in his sketch. You saw the lines that he was creating, and I thought that alone looked great. Then he added this wild fabric, and I just thought, and they talk about it later, just it was too much. And so I think that's where Joanna was going with her comment of the line between hideous and fabulous. Like, this could be an amazing design, but if your print is too much, then you've got too much going on, and then it's hideous. I don't know.
Yeah. And in the workroom, like every season, we see a few people running really late. Suede and Kane were both pushing it. Suede was working on his little cutouts. He's like,
what
I have
they
to
call those things?
Yeah, what did they
called them? I wrote it down because I'm like, payettes.
Payettes.
Is that what they were?
Yes.
I called them dots.
Ugly.
I called them circles that you cut out.
They were bad.
They were bad. We'll get there though. But
we will.
But who else in the workroom did you? Like really, that really stood out to you.
To me, Uli and Anthony Ryan stood out automatically as soon as I saw him in the workroom. Even Joanna, you know, mentioned how beautiful their prints were. So I loved it.
Yeah. You know what I did notice with Joanna? And I didn't know, maybe this was a producer in her ear. But did you notice when she got to Laura Kathleen? Because everybody else that she had been to, she really just talked to them about their design and their fabric. Then she gets to Laura Kathleen and she says to her, is there anyone you're surprised to see here? And Laura Kathleen, I don't remember. She basically just made a comment about, you know, everybody here is really great at sewing. Everybody's good, like a good seamstress. Their technique is really good. But, you know, it's a question of who's a better designer. You know, she didn't really give her a name. And then she got to Ivy and she asked her something about, I don't remember this exact question, but she asked her basically, what do you think about taste levels or something like that? And Ivy quoted Vivian Westwood and said, I just remember her saying, taste, you either have it or you don't.
Yeah, you're born with taste.
Yeah. And I just thought it was interesting that these two characters that we were seeing all the drama from, these are the ones that she was kind of questioning. And I didn't know if it was a way to try and get them to maybe say something about each other, like to have Ivy comment on Laura Kathleen's. I don't know if they would do that with Joanna.
She could have asked everybody these questions, and in editing,
that's true. You're right.
They use these two just because they're trying to create the storyline.
And I bought into it.
And you bought into it. Yeah. Or they're still trying to create the storyline and said, like, listen, just target these two because
they've been having it out.
Exactly.
Yeah. So
either way, they're giving us some some drama.
Yes.
But speaking of iTunes and drama and shows, we love your support on iTunes.
Yes,
rate us, comment. You don't know how much we appreciate it, but you also go on iTunes to check the Project Runway fan favorite app.
I do. So. And I want to say Toy Boat 77, one of our weekly listeners, left a really great comment, and I thought what they said was pretty interesting. They said Suede spoke in the third person all through his season, which I never saw. Did you
Neither
see Suede's season?
No.
No. But Toy Boat still loves him and likes to see him being true to himself.
Okay.
And Toy Boat also said that Althea and Ivy are their least favorites because of how they acted on their own season and hopes that they don't go far. So I thought that was a really great comment, good insight. I like
hearing
we what
like
our,
to hear
listeners have to say. So everyone else that is downloading on iTunes, join the conversation. I want to hear what you have to say, maybe what you have to say about what ToyBoat77 says, what you think about what we're saying. So, yeah, join it. Support us and download. And
we're fans just like you guys. So
I know. So I like to hear what everybody has
to
say.
Me too.
I like
it means a lot.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's interesting because, I don't know, Suede talking in the third person, I think interesting. And also for those of you that watch on YouTube, please comment there as well, because we do look there. We have Ron Kate, who she comments fairly often, and we love her as well. So please keep doing that. And while we're at it, fan favorite,
who's in the lead?
I actually voted for tonight as well. 33% is Team Anthony Ryan. So we see a switch from Casanova, who was last week, to now Anthony Ryan.
Interesting.
Yeah, that is interesting. I wonder what Casanova has. I can't really see.
I would vote for Casanova over Anthony Ryan. Nothing right. against Anthony Ryan, but Casanova is just, he's yes. a fan favorite because that personality, he's so funny, yeah. he's cute. And I just like Uli because...
Yeah, I agree with you. I like Casanova as a fan favorite because he has such a fun personality and he's somebody that I want to see in the competition. Although I know the fan favorite doesn't affect, obviously, who stays in, but I just want to see him do well. However, I will say I did not like his design this week very much and I wasn't really impressed with it last week.
Yeah.
So if I'm going by design, I don't know yet if Casanova really would be my fan favorite. I wanted to point out, though, and I'm kind of bummed, because once you open this Project Runway app, it's very funny. For anybody that has it, it's a picture of the group, and I can't pull it up because it remembers that I've already signed on, so it doesn't show me that first picture. And Laura Kathleen is center, right in the front, with her legs spread wide open, literally, just like spread wide open. She's wearing pants, but... You guys, it's just such a comical photo. If you get this app and you open it, it stood out to me. Just, this is the first thing I see.
Hoochie mama.
It's hysterical. And I'm thinking, the photographer that did this photo shoot, how do you not notice this?
Like, he probably told her to pose like that.
Oh, he noticed it, I'm sure.
Oh, he probably did. But it was just, if you guys have the app, just, it's funny. Take a look at that. So
that is funny.
Yes.
All
moving
right.
on.
Moving on. Let's go on to the runway. The first look was Robert. Oh, no. I'm moving ahead. Okay. Our guest judges yes. were Robert Tagliapietra.
Yeah. Tagliapietra, I think.
Pietra?
Okay. I don't know. We'll hope so.
One or the other. And Jeffrey Costello. They're two yes. designers that are a couple of Anna Wintour's favorites, mm-hmm. as Caroline mentioned. She was wearing, by the way, a very graphic dress.
Yeah.
I liked it. I thought it was cute. It
you
was
mean
appropriate.
Right before the runway?
Yep.
It was definitely appropriate. I particularly didn't like the bottom, because it was, I guess, color blocked in a sense. It was a bottom block of, like, beige. And yeah. I thought maybe any other color but beige would have worked on that dress for me. But other than that, it was appropriate because the top did have some kind of, you know, like a spray paint aesthetic to it.
Yeah.
So she looked cute.
Mm-hmm. So the first look is Andre.
Okay, wait. Before we go there, we have to comment on these two guest judges that look like lumberjacks. I mean, come on.
You're right.
They,
you're right. Robert and Jeffrey?
Yes. They, when they shot over to them, I thought if I ever saw them in a restaurant or if I ever passed
Period.
Them on the street, the last thing I would ever think that they do professionally is
clothing.
I mean, they were like polished lumberjacks, but lumberjacks nonetheless.
Yes.
In that they looked clean.
They were wearing plaid, you guys.
Suspenders, right?
Suspenders. They had beards.
They,
and
yeah.
they were a little overweight.
It was a Brawny commercial just walking around.
Yeah. Almost. Oh, pretty.
A clean. Yeah. Totally. And then, you know, I mean, they weren't lumberjacks, obviously, but they both dressed that way. I just thought it was so funny. Like, just yeah. you would never know.
Designers have really interesting personal style most of the time, though.
Yeah,
so.
They look good. I'm not saying they didn't look good. It just you would never think.
I'm curious to see what their work is like now. So I'm going to look that up.
Yeah,
you guys.
Let's look that up. That'd be
yeah.
fun.
It must be beautiful if mm-hmm. Anna Wintour loves it.
But I thought they were good guest judges. So
they were pretty good.
Yeah.
So first is Andre.
Yes.
And he had this dress that had a white top. Mm-hmm. It was gathered at the waist with some tulle, which I didn't like.
It was like a bow. It was like a big bow with
tulle.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Purple tulle.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And then the skirt had this almost peacock looking graphic print. And then mm-hmm. that same print was on the back. I love the print. It was really mm-hmm. pretty and did not look like spray paint to me at all. And the shape of the dress was cute, but I just, again, with the tulle.
Right.
It was
yeah,
fine.
I feel like Andre, and I don't know him that well, but just from what I've seen of him this season, it's like he may have a good idea and it maybe could work out really well. And then there's just something that he does that takes it a little bit too far. You know, like with the last two episodes, he did this jacket, and maybe the jacket could have been great, but then it was like this sheer jacket, and it looked cheap.
Yeah.
You know, and the same thing with this bow. Maybe if he would have done something different right there and didn't do this big tool bow, it would have looked a bit classier.
Yeah.
But I agree with you on the print. I thought the print was really pretty, and it was actually very subtle, like a very subtle peacock look with those colors in it. And so I like the print, but I don't know. The bow, definitely don't like that.
Yeah. So. Next it was Uli. She made a cocktail dress out of this beautiful, beautiful print. The fit was gorgeous. The only thing that concerned me was this really crazy, sharp, pointy shoulder that mm-hmm. she had created. And I guess it was creative. It was arty, but yeah. artsy, but...
Mm. No, I agree with you. I think the print was gorgeous.
Gorgeous, yeah.
Like, that alone to me... Oh, man, things are falling around here.
Steven, our engineer, disagreed.
He's getting wild over there.
Breaking stuff.
I know. That print was, like, winning to me. Like, I thought that could win. Like, that's
gorgeous.
I thought
she'd be in the top three, at least.
I thought so, too. And what I loved about it was that it was not only this, like, gorgeous, like, orange and red, but right in the center. Because I get, did it have, like, a slit right down?
It was a little slit.
Like, the bust area?
Subtle.
And then around the slit, it was, like, it was kind of like, I don't really even know, like a smeared red. That just kind of framed that slit. So I just thought it was so gorgeous. But I agree with you. The spiky shoulders just – that to me made it look like, okay, so it's artsy and it's runway, but nobody would ever walk down the street wearing that.
Yeah.
Which maybe that's not their goal, you know, to have somebody wear this out and about. But I guess they would be wearing it to an art gallery. Maybe it would work there, but – it would definitely stand out, and people would be like, whoa, her shoulders.
Yeah.
Nutty.
The shoulders took away from the dress for me.
I agree.
Kane, he had the gown we were talking about, plunging neckline and mermaid skirt, really, really loud graphic print that he created. I didn't love it.
Yeah.
It was just too much going on. And honestly, I couldn't even see the specifics of his print because it was all mashed together.
Right.
That huge skirt.
I agree with you. And first of all, Kane, did you hear what he said when his model walked down the runway?
What
did
he say?
I thought, you are nuts. He said, my model looks like Kate Middleton. Kate Middleton would never, ever in her life, ever wear this dress. Never.
Never.
I just like, I
you couldn't pay
even
her.
Hell to the no.
Hell to the no. Because, like, no. Yeah. It wouldn't happen. And I just thought, is he thinking of somebody else? Because that is so wrong.
She has such understated, simple
style. She's so classy, simple, not this big, wild, loud graphic and plunging to, like, your belly button. No. aside from his ridiculous comment, the design, I agree with you. In the mermaid design, at the very end, where it actually mermaided out, however you would say that, there was so much extra fabric. So you really couldn't – all you could see was a bunch of loud and different wild mashed together colors. You didn't really see so much of his technique. But again, I'll stick to what I said in that I liked the concept. I liked the cut of it. And you know what I actually like that the guest designers did not like? They didn't like how he outlined, like, in the skirt of the dress, because the outline that he had, you know, kind of shaped her hips. And even in the back kind of went around her butt.
Yeah.
And he said, you know, he said that it gave it girth. Yeah. And he's like, you know, I don't want to look big or whatever he said. Something like that. And I actually liked that shape. I liked the outline that he did. I didn't like the outline at the knee.
Or
you know,
the bottom.
That, exactly. I didn't like that. But I liked the cut of it. I liked the fit. And I just feel like if he would have toned down his print or maybe used softer colors or not as much of the black outline, it could have had better reviews.
Laura Kathleen, she had a really pretty print, in my opinion. It was purple and yellow. She had some splatter going on in front. I like the shape of the dress too. It was a little too short, mm-hmm. with the weird hem in the front. But I hated the back. She uses cheap black fringe to outline the cutout in the back, and it was executed terribly. It cheapened the dress to me, and I was like, just don't turn around.
Yeah, just don't turn around. Yeah. Why'd you have to do that? Killed
it. I know.
I agree with you. I liked the color combination, the green, purple, yellow. The back fringe, yes, it looked cheap. What I liked about her trying to do that was that it was different, it was a contrast, and it was unexpected. And I couldn't agree more with Isaac Mizrahi when he said he liked the idea of it, but he didn't like it.
Yeah.
Like, she was going for something that maybe could have worked, and I personally just liked the contrast of the kind of dress that she was going for, and then, you know, the kind of style that you think of when you think of that fringe. There's definitely a contrast there, but it could work if it's done right, I think, and she just didn't do it right. And you're right. She had a weird hem up in the front. It basically came up in a V.
Yeah.
And then it was too short on top of that.
Yeah.
So, and she noticed that too when she walked down the runway, when the model walked down the runway. She noticed that her design was a little too short, you know, than she would have liked it to have been. But so no, she didn't get great reviews. That's for sure.
Anthony Ryan was my personal favorite. Mm-hmm. He had this short little A-line skirt dress, and the print was just stunning. It was this bright blue and black print that he created, and I just thought it looked so expensive, really well done.
Really?
Oh, I loved it.
Okay. He was my favorite of the top, but okay. I don't know if he was my favorite of the night.
So, but he was my personal favorite. Yeah. I loved it. I'd wear that dress. And I believe it had, did it, the back have a cutout? I want to say,
yes.
Yeah.
Basically, it kind of had a cutout, like a little square or like rectangular
subtle
kind of cutout at the lower back,
yeah.
Because from, you know, the top to the bottom, right in the center, he had like a thick black, you know, band, I guess you would say, of fabric that kind of divided it. And then that band came around to the back, but that's, I think, where it was cut out. Like, it didn't actually connect.
I didn't see the band in the front.
Well, and maybe it was just on the sides. Like, he did have a partial, like, blocked black band around her waist. But what I loved about his fabric was what he did. You're right. It had the blue and the black lines, which at first when I saw him doing that, I thought, okay, it's cool, but is it not cool enough? Like, is that just, I'm just going to do a bunch of lines. You know, I didn't know if it was as creative, where I saw, you know, Uli, who did this like amazing technique, or even Althea, who like did a really cool technique. And I think that's why his print didn't impress me as much. But I thought the dress was cute. The cut was cute. It even had pockets. It looked like the model put her hands in some pockets. What I loved about it, though, was up at the neck, where he did smaller little, more like smudges. Like, they weren't so much lines, but they were just like little black smudges. So it kind of created that neckline that's really popular, as if like you're wearing like a necklace, you know? So he did that, and I thought that was cute. And I actually really liked the styling of his girl. I like the hair that he did.
I didn't love the hair.
The big old whatever it's called. Yeah.
It was like an upside down twist. French twist.
I thought it went really well with the design and the dress. So that's, I mean, if it was on somebody else, maybe I wouldn't have loved it. But I thought altogether, the look that came down, he did a really great job.
Casanova had a halter dress.
Yeah.
I think it was jeweled. The halter top was jeweled, the neckline. And then it was just the chiffon-y, unforgettable print.
It was so forgettable. I don't even think
boring.
I can describe it. Because it was weird. It didn't have any consistency to it.
No.
It was almost like it had some kind of color on this side, and it was different on this other side. And even on the back, wasn't there like a little patch of like sparkle on the
back?
Yeah,
there was like little gems.
Just random. I didn't like it. I didn't like it at all, actually.
It was boring to me.
I like Casanova, but I didn't like this dress.
Emilio, he had the flame fire looking suit. It was a play on a denim jacket. And then I believe it was a red top. Maybe it wasn't a skirt suit. I mean, it was a skirt and top suit.
Mm-hmm.
And then the matching skirt.
Right. And he's the one that did the blood the dripping technique.
Correct.
What I liked, well, you could go ahead. Tell me what you thought.
No,
about
I just,
it.
I liked it. I think I liked the art behind it. I liked the execution. It was really well made. But I personally didn't love the print. It was just a little bright.
That's exactly what I was going to say. I think the print maybe could have been really great if it wasn't so bright. That yellow was, whoa.
Like, it looked like fire to me.
She could come out at night and be like reflecting things.
Yeah.
You will not miss her. She might hurt your eyes. Like, it was just too bright for me. But other than that, I think he blended his pattern well in the jacket. You know, I think Isaac Mizrahi said, if you were to see that jacket, you wouldn't know that that was actually spray paint. And I agreed with that. A lot of people didn't like the belt that he had that kind of tied the jacket together.
It looked
kind of
cheap.
And I agree with that. It did look kind of cheap. And then the skirt was like a
pencil skirt.
And at the bottom, it was kind of like
and
spray paint, kind of color blocked a little bit down at the bottom.
Yeah.
It's just that yellow is...
I didn't love the zippers either, but I like the shape of the jacket.
I like the little red top underneath.
The shape of the jacket was cute.
Yeah. I didn't mind the back zipper.
Suede.
Oh, God.
Let's
get there.
Suede. Yeah. Here's the paillettes we were talking about, the little circle paillettes. He created this polka dot effect. Mm-hmm. I hated that it fit terribly. I hated the shape, the silhouette, and obviously the paillettes.
Yeah, the paillettes were, you know what I think about the paillettes? I think they were just oversized. I think if you had gone with maybe that technique in a smaller size, it could have looked not so cheap and not so crafty. That's my thing with suede. Everything that has come down the runway from him that I have seen is so crafty. It looks like a little kid's art project.
That's a great way to describe it.
I mean, it's just so bad. So the paillettes were bad. It was this one shoulder piece, if you guys didn't see it. The paillettes on the top. And then this, like, poofy skirt. It was, like, poofy, but then it kind of was piecey at the bottom.
The hem wasn't a straight.
It wasn't, like, it wasn't real. Yeah, it was
It was like a scarf skirt.
And then just black with green and then more just random paillettes on this big puffy
skirt. No
horrendous.
Taste. Althea, she had a pretty print that we already discussed. It almost looked like giraffe and she used that technique.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a tight cocktail dress. It was really flattering. I thought it was cute. It didn't stand out to me, but it was a pretty dress. And I think a lot of women would love it.
I would wear that. I thought it was really pretty. I liked it looked almost sporty at the top, how it fit. And then it had this, like, kind of tight little V slit up at the top. And then on the sides, like, the side of her thighs was black panels. So it wasn't, like, the white with the giraffe print all over. That print was more just down the center of her body and kind of moved to her shape. And I really liked that. I thought it was a really pretty, classy dress. You're right. Didn't stand out, though.
No.
Much.
Ivy, she had the graphic print that looked like comic book.
Yeah, the pal
writing
that she was inspired by.
Holy cow, that donut.
Whoa.
Thank you. Wow. We need to give a round.
I don't even know what that is.
It sounds like Batman.
Holy hole in a donut? Oh, okay.
Very appropriate, because that's what it did look like.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was a blazer top and then this asymmetrical skirt. I liked it from the top half. I liked the cutout in the back. Mm-hmm. I really liked the shape and style of the jacket. I didn't love the print, but I thought for the challenge it was appropriate.
I didn't like the print at all. I didn't like that she actually spray painted words onto her outfit. I just didn't think it was designer. You know, it wasn't artsy designer. It was literally just, it was very literal to me in terms of the challenge. But I liked the cut. I did like the jacket. I liked that it was like a cutout in the back or just short in the back. And I liked the fit of it. what the judges said that I totally agreed with was that, you know, the skirt.
The asymmetrical chiffon hanging?
Yeah, and it was white, yeah, which didn't really work with the colors in her.
I didn't like that hanging chiffon at
either.
All. Just cut it off.
I totally agree with you. I don't know why they didn't say that, actually.
Yeah.
But I was at least glad that they were just like, why would you do white right there? Like, if anything, you would do orange or I don't know, something else. But I agree. I thought it looked cheap to me. Yeah. That white chiffon thing. I didn't like it.
And then last but not least, Josh had a peplum cocktail dress, mm-hmm, and it was made out of a pretty bright graffiti, and his looked, mm-hmm, kind of literal too. It looked like graffiti print. I didn't like it. I thought it was boring and predictable, and
really?
I feel like Josh's stuff is really predictable and kind of Sears looking.
Sears. I like that you have a very, like, that's funny.
I don't know. Kind of. This is terrible, but I think it could be a part of Kardashian collection.
Well, maybe. A lot of people like Kardashians, though.
I know. I like the Kardashians, but like.
I know. I hear you.
Look, like, I don't
well,
know.
I'm just going to say I actually liked his. I thought it was cut really well. I thought it was a pretty dress. You know what I thought was interesting, too, was when, yeah, I definitely liked the fit. It looked well made. And I liked the design of the peplum because it was more, like, to one side. It wasn't just straight peplum all the way around. It kind of was, like, shorter maybe on the left side and then peplumed out to the right and kind of had a little bit of a pleat in the peplum, which I thought that was a really cool design look. I liked the back had the cutout. And then the little band that he had kind of went at a diagonal across her back. And then it was a pencil skirt. But what I thought was really cool and probably very tricky was that the pattern on the skirt didn't totally look like it would go with the pattern on the top. Like, it didn't look like it was cut from the same piece.
Really? I didn't notice that.
That was my personal opinion. It looked like he did one design on one thing and another design on another, but they actually worked together. But they looked very different. So I thought
maybe
that was kind of cool. I thought that was kind of cool. So I actually liked his. I thought for me, he might have been in my top.
Really?
For, I don't know if he would have won if it was up to me, if I was the judge, because I'm not. But he would have been in my top.
Interesting. He wouldn't have been on the bottom for me.
Right. Well, because you have Suede, so why would Jonathan be in the bottom?
Oh, and Suede, Kane, and
exactly.
I'd find somebody else because Josh was not as bad as them.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so let's move on to the winner tonight. I was kind of surprised because I was going for Anthony Ryan, my favorite.
Right.
Emilio.
I'm very surprised. Wasn't it Carolyn? She wanted that outfit.
Oh,
she was like, I want it. I want to wear it. And she was dead serious.
Oh, she loved it.
Whoa.
That's
this is
a
too
lot.
Loud for me. Yeah, it's too loud. But I was surprised. You predicted that, by the way. Did you know that? Remember last week, that was your prediction. It was either last week or the week before that you predicted that Emilio would kind of like come up.
You're
that
right.
We were going to see something good from him. You called it.
What
Look
can I
that.
Say?
I know. You're good. You're a professional. That's why you do what you do.
And the loser was Suede.
The loser was Suede. I'm
Suede has
not
to go
sad
home.
About that.
Neither do
Suede.
I.
Suede. And even Suede said Suede has to go home because Suede talks in the third person.
Listen,
oh, it's so bad.
His taste level is just not there.
He's probably That's right. He's probably a really sweet person, but
we're not judging
he
on their personality.
He should be a craft teacher, like a arts and crafts. He should do that.
He should.
I hate to say that, but it could be a very fun job.
It could.
I would imagine that would
honestly,
be a very fun job.
Michael's is hiring. Yeah. They have scrapbook night.
They have craft night and workshops.
Don't ask me how I know that.
You know, little kids, they love paillettes, I'm sure. They probably decorate
Imagine.
Them. They want
the
to roll in paillettes.
Are endless.
Put glue all over themselves, roll them in paillettes, and you've got happy kids. So I could just Suede. You're missing your calling right now. That's my opinion. I have some news and gossip before we get to that.
Yes, let's do it, Lauren.
I apologize if it's not so perfectly put together, but there were just a few things that I noticed in the news that I thought were worth mentioning. I read that Joanna Coles will be joining the 100 New York City Fun Fearless Females at the Sexiest Power Lunch in Manhattan.
Oh, well deserved.
Yeah, that's going to be on Monday. And basically, because we know that Joanna is the new editor-in-chief of Cosmo, and I believe this is a yearly event that Cosmo puts on, and it is to celebrate New York's most influential women. Expected guests, from what I read on New York Post, are Diane von Furstenberg, Gail King, and Kathy Black, who's the former New York school's chancellor. That's one thing. Also, regarding Joanna Coles, I don't know if you guys saw, but she tweeted about the election. I think she was happy that Obama won. She tweeted, "Single girls get to keep on having sex and health care." So that was Joanna's take on the win. Also about the election, we have to give a shout out to the Project Runway judge, Michael Kors, who designed Michelle Obama's dress.
You're right.
And, you know, I saw that Michelle Obama often wears his dress, and it's always a similar one. I don't know if it's the same one.
She's
but it's
worn
very
that
similar.
Dress before.
Yeah, she has. So it's a recurring dress, and you kind of got to love her for that. Like, that you see her wearing the same dress over and over again.
Power to her.
Power to her.
We all wear clothes again.
Exactly. And that was our man, Michael Kors,
go
from
Michael.
Project Runway.
Boop, boop.
And then I just could not refrain from bringing this up. I read in an article about our favorite Dimitri. So for those of you who didn't join us last season, you need to know who Dimitri is. And for those of you that did, you share our love of Dimitri. But I read on theclicker.today.com, which is the blog of MSN, I believe, of today.com. Mm-hmm. They did an interview with Nina and also with Dimitri after his win. Nina was quoted as saying that Dimitri's win was unanimous, which I thought that was interesting to note.
Interesting.
We didn't know that. But some great things that Dimitri was quoted as saying, first of all, that's interesting. Heidi took half of my collection. I'm the only designer whom she took clothing from, as far as I know. When they were bagging the collection, they put Heidi's name on half of it, and it went to Los Angeles. Okay. And we all know that Dimitri won money to start his own line, but until that happens, he says that he's going to be catching up on one of his favorite shows, Dancing with the Stars. Is that not hysterical? Because we always talk about how he's the ballroom dancer, and it just so fits his personality.
Oh.
He says he loves it. He quit ballroom dancing 15 years ago from his childhood, and they even asked him if he would do it, and he said he would love to. So,
am I going to see Dimitri on Dancing with the Stars?
Would that not be the best if we did?
We'd have to cover it.
I agree. He's just too fantastic.
He would be a dancer, though, not a contestant, right?
Well, on Dancing
or
with the Stars.
Both.
Oh.
He couldn't be a contestant. He's an expert.
Yeah, that's true. I don't know. But we just love him.
Dimitri.
And so I thought we needed to mention him in the
Great
news.
I can't wait to see Heidi in his clothes.
Yeah, and another thing about this 100 New York Fun Fearless Females, I think they'll probably show, you know, who was in it in Cosmo coming up.
Great, so let's
kind of
look out for that.
Yeah, that's all I got.
All right, another fun week, you guys. Thank you so much for listening and watching.
No predictions?
I don't know.
I don't have a prediction.
Yeah, we're
Steve.
Too early.
What's your prediction?
Yeah.
I predict that a lot of people are going to keep watching you two doing this after show.
All right.
I
like that, too. That's a good way to close.
Yes.
All right. Listen to our very knowledgeable engineer, you guys. Keep listening because we love doing this. And thanks,
Lauren.
See you next week.
Where can we find you?
Oh.
Follow me on Twitter @_Alina23.
And you can follow me @Lo_Vias.
Let's keep the combo going. Thanks, guys.
From Bing.com, executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Oh, buzz,
buzz you later.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.